You're here, and it's a special occasion because, as our guest reminded me, when you go back in San Diego's political history, here's a fact that you probably don't know. In the history of San Diego, there have only been two elected constitutional officers. Everyone knows about Mayor Wilson. Hardly anyone remembers Bert Betts, who was the state controller. He was a guy out of Lemon Grove, somehow got his way onto the ticket with Pat Brown, and the Democrats swept everything. And so he served 8 years as controller, and I happen to be the chief of staff for the lieutenant governor. So I kind of know that, but most people don't. But as our guest pointed out, so you go back to Jim Mills when he was president pro tem of the California State Senate, hugely influential guy, but because he was a Democrat, was barely acknowledged in this town, seriously. We would not have the trolley system without Jim Mills. I think most people know that. And then Pete Wilson, 20 years on, became both U.S. Senator and Governor. And now, for the first time, the Speaker of the California State Assembly is a San Diegan. Isn't that fantastic? But it's even better because of who she is. She served with such great distinction on the city council, got elected to the legislature, and now is the speaker. And she's terrific. Just a really, really wonderful person. Sometimes people in public office aren't, but the majority are, and she's exceptional even by that measure. So would you welcome, please, the Speaker of the California State Assembly, the Honorable Toni Atkins.
Well, thank you, George. And I want to say thank you both to City Club and La Jolla Country Day for inviting me. I'm thrilled to be here. And thank you for offering Chris to invite me back. What I'd really like, however, is to be invited to Camp Tori's behind the scenes at Petco Park. Now that sounds cool, so I just thought I'd put that on your list. And I was feeling, after this I'm going off to a soccer field to see some young folks play soccer, and I thought, I don't really know how to dress today. How do you dress as a speaker and then go off to a soccer field? But now I haven't seen George Mitrovich today. I'm not feeling so bad. I'm not feeling so bad about not looking the speaker part, so I hope you'll forgive me for that. And George, thank you for making me feel right at home. I was asked to talk a little bit about the state of the state, and so I came prepared to do a little bit of that. And I think I can sum it up with two kinds of thoughts. One, California is really back, and I'm going to talk about what that means a little bit. But we're also, unfortunately, really dry, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. After probably the longest and severest recession since the Great Depression, California has turned the corner, and it hasn't been without great sacrifice and on the parts of many in this state. Last week's news that our unemployment rate has finally dropped to 7.4%, the lowest rate in 6 years, is the latest sign, and that's good news. And to remind us that California is a $2 trillion economy. We are still the eighth largest economy in the world. And we love it when we hear things like Forbes recently named San Diego, San Francisco, and San Jose as among the best cities in the nation to start a business. And again, I said we are the eighth largest economy in the world, so I love to say to Rick Perry, sorry, Rick, but we're really not in competition with Texas. We're in competition with Brazil and with France and with Germany. And just recently, we surpassed Italy and Russia. I think that has a lot to do with their economic downturn, but we'll take it. But that doesn't mean we don't have a lot of work to do and that we don't have dialogue about what makes us business friendly and what makes us be able to be one of the greatest places to live throughout California in the world. It doesn't mean we don't have challenges. So our turnaround, I think, is due to a number of factors. To tough cuts from the legislature and the governor that we were forced to make. When I got elected, we had a $26 billion deficit. And I thought it was difficult at the city of San Diego dealing with millions, try billions. It was really difficult. And we felt that. As everyday Californians, we felt that. We felt that in education, health and human services, all kinds of ways. But I think the voters had a huge role to play in the turnaround of California. I also remember that Economist article when I got elected that talked about ungovernable California. It was April of 3.5 years ago. I will never forget. I still have that edition of the Economist. And so the voters played a big role, I think, in two ways. One, you allowed us as a state to pass a budget with a majority vote so that we aren't dealing with budgets being approved into, you know, our statutory date is July 15th. So that means that we don't, June 15th, what am I talking about? June 15th, which means that we aren't, as you recall from years past, still trying to get a budget passed in August, September, and even into October. So because of the voters, for the last 4 years, we have approved a budget on time. And this year, for the first time in many years, we have a fairly significant surplus. That's thanks to the voters, because you gave us the ability to do that. You gave us the tools to be a more functional government. You also, maybe some of you in this room, I hope, supported the passage of Proposition 30, which actually gave the state a buffer. It gave it a buffer. I think the voters said, we will help you, but you need to be prudent, you need to be responsible, and you need to help us turn the state around. Our economic growth has been pretty much flat and operating at about 2%. So you gave us Proposition 30, which has allowed us really to start to deal with structural issues within our budget. So Governor Brown, I think as a result of my success in becoming Speaker, actually came to San Diego and signed our budget, fourth time in a row, on time, and now with some surpluses. But we have to be fiscally responsible, and I think the voters expect that of us. Citizens expect that of us. And so we're trying to make smart investments. We're trying to put money aside and maintain stability as we try to make sure our state is on fiscal footing, sound fiscal footing. But we also want to invest. We want to expand and invest in people. So how did we do that? How are some of the ways that we did that? We increased Proposition 98, that's our school funding, for K through 12 schools by $5 billion. That was part of Prop 30. That's a 10.3 increase over what was provided in the Budget Act of 2013, so last year. And of this increase, $4.7 billion is for local control funding for school districts. So school districts locally need to be able to figure out how best to spend that money. And we also provided $300 million additional dollars for community colleges. We're proud of our community college system here in San Diego. We have an excellent one. And so we increased that funding for the, you know, first time, a little bit last year, but for really significance this year. We increased funding for UC and CSU by $142 million each system. We had provided another $100 million increase for UC-CSU if the Department of Finance found that our 2013-14 property tax revenues exceeded projections. They did not. So we couldn't trigger that additional $100 million. So unfortunately, the Department of Finance said we didn't do it, so we don't get to trigger that $100 million. But our general fund revenues came in nearly $400 million over projections. The good news is we're trying to project conservatively. The governor does, his Department of Finance does, the Legislative Analyst Office does, and I think that's good for us. But we came in $400 million above projections. And so we probably, when we go back in August, we'll introduce some legislation that would meet our promise to the students while maintaining our fiscal stability and responsibility. We will move legislation to make that $100 million a reality because our UC and CSU system have plans for that money in terms of expansion enrollment for our students. A number of things, because I think most of you in this room, I see educators. I see people who, well, I see educators, but I also know that education is one of the issues that Californians care the most about. And economists will tell you that the quickest way to grow jobs and to grow your economy is to invest in your people via education. So we want to keep that commitment. We guaranteed another investment that I'm particularly happy about, which is one of my top personal priorities. We were able to invest over $165 million to develop affordable housing. And when you look up and down the state of California, you see that we have some of the least affordable places to live in the country. That's a list we make every year that we're not thrilled about. Los Angeles, San Francisco, San Diego, and even parts, other parts of the state that traditionally have been lower cost places to live. So we're investing about $165 million this next year in the development of affordable housing. That creates good jobs. We know that we have a construction industry. We know that we need housing in the state of California. We have 38 million people, and by 2050, we're projected to have double that amount of population. So we know that we need housing. We need generally housing built, but we also need affordable housing so that the people who were born here can still afford to live here. So that's important, and we're trying to do that. And just as an aside, California has approximately 135,000 homeless individuals. So we've got some work to do, and certainly we want to try to make smart investments as we move forward. But we also want to help lift some people out of poverty. We have children in poverty, families in poverty. And at the same time that we are trying to do things like pay down our debt, we significantly paid down debt this year, more than $12 billion. We've repaid all of the money that we actually owe schools from the years that we couldn't meet our obligation to schools, and so we held back money, but we kept an accounting of what we owed the school system, and we've paid that down. We have grown our reserves. By 2017, we should have $5 billion in reserves, and that's separate from the rainy day fund that we want to put together. Everyone's sort of chuckling when I say rainy day fund. Now, since we've had no rain, they feel like it'd be good to have rain and a fund. So we're working on both, hopefully. But the rainy day fund, I hope you will support. What it does is it further cements our ability to make sure that we are not able to touch that money unless there's an absolute emergency that is declared and discussed by the governor. So we've put harder criteria there to make sure that we are keeping a reserve so that if we move into another one of the recessions, of course, we've just had the worst one, you see that we're not making the dire cuts that we've had to make over the last decade. So there's certainly a lot of work ahead, particularly making sure that we back up good economic news and we make sure we have the right approach to create more good-paying jobs in our state. We all want a healthy business climate. But Californians have made it clear time and time again that we also want a healthy environment and a healthy quality of life. And so we have to strike the right balance to make sure that we can help businesses start and succeed, and certainly to have a state that we want to live in. And that's our dialogue. And I, so many times, find myself in a group that wants to focus on one piece of that dialogue. And they want me to defend that one piece of the dialogue. And then I'll find myself in another group that totally agrees that the Global Warming Act of 2006, AB 32, was the best thing we could have ever done. So I end up before each of those groups usually wanting to push that issue. And what I say is, this is not an easy dialogue. Californians want to protect the environment. You couldn't have more proof of that than when Californians rejected Proposition 23, which was the proposition that tried to undo AB 32, the Global Warming Act. And if you think about it, those who want to push that back actually have more money and resources. So it was a well-financed campaign against Californians who really want to protect the environment. Now, having said that, it doesn't mean we don't have dilemmas when we're trying to figure out how to help businesses who create jobs continue to be able to do that in the face of growing regulations that require them to pay more so that we can have technologies and the ability to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. That translates into real companies and real jobs. Jobs by the oil industry, which, by the way, employs a heck of a lot of people in Central Valley. So these are not easy discussions. And what I like about it is that we can push each other to have, I think that's what the City Club is all about, how to have those discussions and the debate and have it in a civil manner in which you're trying to deal with the facts and come to some solutions and work towards solutions and improvements for our community and for our state. So when people try to relegate these discussions to black and white or hard and fast facts and issues. It's not that simple. And that's what I get to do every day. Earlier this week, I got to talk to the Union Tribune editorial board. That was really enjoyable. They had me on my toes trying to answer all those difficult questions, and I kept trying to tell them the same thing. This is a dialogue between citizens in this state who actually believe both. And today, you're seeing all of the articles about, well, yeah, I support reduction of greenhouse gas emissions in our state, but I don't want to pay more for gasoline, you know? And what's really interesting about that discussion is, you know, we have so many industries that have been stakeholders in this dialogue and process with Cal EPA, and they've been part of this discussion for years to help them as businesses, because you need to be able to have certainty in businesses. My spouse is a small business owner, and she's like, you've got to know the rules. You've got to have certainty. You've got to know how you can operate. And so I want to assure you, that discussion has been going on since 2006, and the legislation was passed, and then multiple years where people with greater minds than mine, scientifically, of course, but then how do you implement it and make sure that it works and gives businesses time to adjust? And then if you want to add to that, what we've also been able to do, and, you know, I really want to credit Governor Brown. He really, you know, this is his second time around. And you know, I actually got to tell you, I think he's pretty cool to talk to. You never know where he's going. You know, that's one thing. And he's incredibly bright and brilliant. But, you know, I said to him, what's it feel like to be in this position a second time? He said, well, you know, before, everybody was older than me. You know, I had to listen to all these people. They were all older than me. He said, now I'm older than everybody else. And he says, I think it's time they listen to me. And, you know, I kind of appreciated that comment, but I give him a lot of credit because he has really pushed the fiscal responsibility part. And then some of us are having to push back on him and say, well, we've had such drastic cuts for a decade that have affected real people that we gotta do the balance. So we've got a healthy tension between the governor. He holds us back. We push him. It's really a good dynamic. But I want to credit him because it was him and his idea that early on, and this is about the jobs creation piece of that dialogue between protecting our environment and creating jobs, he pushed the retooling of the enterprise zone tax credit. And so now we have a program called California Competes, and we just allocated a board. We have a community board made up of community people as well as people from the administration that allocated $30 million in tax credits. About $4.5 million came to businesses in San Diego County, including Petco and a number of others, to expand business. And the criteria are, we want to help you expand business or open new businesses, and we will give you tax breaks to do that. Next year, we'll have $150 million in California Competes. So that's our reaction to Governor Perry. We are trying to create good jobs. We are putting subsidies behind corporations. Large, medium-sized, and small can compete for these tax credits, and there are different categories, so that we can help business grow. And you may have seen in the news that we are certainly trying to support our aerospace industry, and we allocated potential credits, should they be awarded the contract from the Department of Defense, to Lockheed Martin. When we go back, we're going to be looking at a similar possibility for credits with Northrop Grumman. We passed legislation to support the development of a battery manufacturing plant for green vehicles, electric vehicles. So you see that Tesla, we are trying to compete to keep Tesla in our state because, you know, California is the green state. We are the state that wants to use the ability for green technology to create jobs. So we have a lot going on to try to spur economic development and jobs and growth, and we're going to keep doing that. So I just want us to think critically. You know, I had the advantage of a really good education, and here we are at La Jolla Country Day, and George was talking about this fabulous student and young people and how we get young people invested in what we're doing here. And I think critical thinking is an important part of that. And so I think part of my job as a legislator or elected official or public servant is really to push us to have those discussions and not accept the simple answers. And don't accept the, the buzz phrases and the buzzwords, because, you know, there's a lot more to it than that. And that's the part of the job I have to tell you I love. It's about helping the community have more information than they have, because I have access to that because of the work I do. And so I think that's pretty cool. On another front, I wanted to talk a little bit about, and then I want to stop because I'm hoping we can have a dialogue, right, George? That's what, okay, great. I'm looking forward to that. We know that we're in a serious drought. A U.S. drought monitor map released last week showed that 81% of California is in the category of extreme drought or worse. And now that our state has seen its share of water shortages, the current crisis we face goes beyond anything that we've seen. Well, in fact, this is the worst drought since California began keeping records more than a century ago. And earlier this year, the legislature provided about $687 million in previously unspent bond funds for drought relief efforts. And that included accelerating water supply projects, projects that were ready to go, expanding use of recycled water and storm water, requiring better groundwater management, and increasing penalties for illegal diverting of water related to water rights. And for families and individuals who have been economically harmed by the drought, food and housing assistance and job training money also went into that. And just to explain what that means, there are areas that we are now not developing agriculture because we don't have the water. And so there are people who work in that industry. And so now they have been hard hit. And so some of that resources was to help in that way. It's not a problem that legislation can solve alone. As Californians, we need to be part of the solution and conserve water. And I'm really proud to be from San Diego County, where I can talk about the fact that, you know, we're water dependent, and we have been for a very long time. But because the last major drought, we had to import more water from the north than we were used to importing. We had to diversify our water portfolio, and people here reacted very well. Since 2006, we have actually, we've gotten to the point where we use 27% less water since that time, 2006, and we've increased our population by 600,000. That's pretty incredible. Now, it took a lot of people and a lot of work to get there. And we have seen our water use increase slightly in the last year, probably due to the heat. But San Diego has a very good story to tell, because we've had dialogue with very diverse groups of people to talk about things like storage. We've just raised both of our dams. San Vicente, Liebenheim dams have been raised in order to be able to store more water for when we don't have water. You know, we're under construction on a desalination plant. You know that we're talking about water reuse, and we're at the point where we're talking to the State Department of Public Health about how to move forward with our water reuse project. We have water from the Colorado River, you know. We get water from the north, and we have the agreement with the Imperial Irrigation Water District. So San Diego has diversified because we've had to, and I'm proud of that, but it's still not enough because we are looking at a very serious crisis. So I will say that when we go back, you know, it's been an incredible 8 weeks. I got sworn in as speaker on May 12th. The next day, the governor came out with his May revision to the budget, which meant budget, 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 all the way until we had, that primary election thing, which I'm also responsible for as speaker in my Democratic caucus. So it was budget, 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 election, election, back to budget, pass the budget. And now we've got 1 month left to do the rest of our legislation. And in that first week we go back, we've got to deal with water. We've got to have a reasonable water bond that we can put on the ballot. Now, right now we have a bond that a previous assembly put together. I wasn't there at that point. But we've had to move it a couple of times because the legislature was concerned, because of our recession, that citizens wouldn't vote for a water bond in the midst of major fiscal crisis. We've moved beyond that, but the bond that we have for the ballot is an $11.19 billion bond. It ended up, to get the votes you needed, it needed a two-thirds vote to put it on the ballot by the legislature. It ended up needing a lot of votes, so, you know, we call it the Christmas tree approach. I don't mean to be religiously undiverse, but That's what we called it, the Christmas tree approach, and everybody needed to get an ornament on the tree in order to give their vote. They needed something for their area. They needed stuff for their communities. And so it ended up being an $11.19 billion bond. Well, we're very concerned that people won't vote for such a high bond. Now, they may, depend upon how dry it is on election day in November, but if we get a few days of rain, maybe people will feel better about that and not want to spend $11.19 billion, which is debt. It can do good things, but it's still debt. So our challenge, and the governor really thinks this is too high a bond. He really does. That's the frugal part of him. I swore I wouldn't say he was cheap. That's the frugal part of Jerry Brown. So he wants a $6 billion bond. And we think that that is just too minimal to do the kind of needs that we need to do on water in the near future, because we'll have to go back for another one to do more infrastructure. This is about water infrastructure up and down the state. And what's interesting about a water bond, it's not a Democratic or a Republican issue. It's not a caucus issue. It's a regional issue. So that makes it really interesting in terms of how you pull votes together to put something on the ballot. So we think the $6 billion suggestion the governor is putting forward is too little to get enough done that really helps the infrastructure. We think the $11.19 billion, we all sort of agree that that's too much. The Senate tried a $10.5 billion budget that failed. We have an $8.2 billion package that deals with things like recycling, groundwater, storage, those kinds of things, and we've brought the amount down, and we may have to go down a little more, but I will just say in the week that we go back, that will be the biggest focus because we have effectively until August 12th. And I think it was Rita Mae Brown that said there's nothing like a deadline to get some work done. And it just never fails the legislature. You know, we have the deadline of the budget. We have this deadline to get this on the ballot. And we're going to work up probably until the last possible minute when we all finally believe it's a real thing, we have to do it. So I hope that we're able to do that. I think it's critically important, and that will be my focus in the week that I go back. I think I have talked long enough about the most important things, but I'm happy to hear your comments and take your questions. And George, you're going to facilitate that? Wonderful. Thank you for your time and letting me say a few things.
A question in our history as a state, 1912. So we have a corrupt legislature, and the governor puts a number of things on the ballot which pass. And California's population in 1912 was 2,750,000. And the idea that the initiative process was born. And a lot of people, I'm certainly one of them, believe the initiative process is just out of control. What is the sense in Sacramento about it? Is there any sense at all that maybe we could do something about it?
So the initiative process, I think the sense is, as an elected official, a politician, if you will, that this is a discussion that needs to be driven by the people as opposed to elected officials. I think I've yet to see too many people that don't think that system is broken and that maybe it could use some reform, if not outright change. I mean, we have more ballot initiatives than I think any other state. I know you're a historian and an observer of politics and process. I think it's broken. I think there needs to be a higher level of support for something before it's put on the ballot. And then we get into the whole discussion. It's yet another dialogue that's hard. There is no sense from the legislature that we can find a way to tackle that won't be negative and harsh feedback from voters. Because if you don't have the dialogue and discussion about whether this is a good or bad thing, people mostly think, well, don't take my democracy away. This is the democratic process. But I think those of us who know that democratic process can turn into people who are paid to gather signatures at a grocery store, and if you say, do you support teachers? Yeah. Well, you got to read the fine print, and most of us don't. And I have stopped signing anything, even stuff I like, because my thought is, I don't know what's in there, and I don't know how, but there is no political appetite. I think that's unfortunate, but the other thing is, much like tax reform, I think there's a feeling that it's got to come from the citizens. And I think citizens are pretty tired of having to sign all the initiatives, and I think they're tired when they get their voting guide and they realize what they have to vote on, and you're busy calling around your friends that might know a little more on this issue versus that to say, what is this? But I don't think there's a political appetite.
Yes, Dr. Brown.
You know, to use Edward Durkin's famous remark, a billion here and a billion there, and pretty soon you're talking about real money. And so this is what you talk about all the time. But I'd like to ask you something that I really have no feeling for at all. And that is, where do you people go to get your information, to get the start of the dialogue from experts as to what do we really need, in terms of what? In terms of moving millions of people in and out of big metropolis areas like Los Angeles, transportation. What do we do in terms of housing? Because you say it's a billion here and a billion there and 8 million there and whatever it is, but where do you go to say, okay, what do you knowledgeable people think about the 50-year water plan for California? Are we going up to the Columbia River and laying a lot of PVC pipe? Are we taking it from the ocean? Because we're going to need more as well as saving it. And the same thing is true with transportation. You look at a carbon footprint, all you need is one picture of an LA freeway mess, and you see how much carbon we're burning, go nowhere. So these big, big issues, you've got to get your information from somewhere. Could you tell us a little bit about that process?
I can, and let me just ask our video guy. You got that question, I hope, because if I have to repeat that question, okay, good. well, we do have access to experts, but the real question is, do we listen to them? Let's be clear. And some of us, yes, we do, and some of us, we don't. We have the ability to put forward legislation. Every legislator does. You know, I can try to talk someone out of something that I think is really crazy as speaker, but, you know, some you can, you can't. People put forward legislation. We have lots of expertise. We have the legislative analysts, budget office. They're incredibly good. We have, I would say the governor's got some really great people. We have UC Berkeley. We have Stanford. We have UCSD. We have think tanks. We have advisory boards that have, take any issue, transportation, the environment. We have scientific advisory bodies. I serve on the Ocean Protection Council. We have a scientific body that advises us on those issues so that we can try to take the politics out of things. So we have lots of experts. And California has more resources and options, I think, than almost anywhere in the world. We are the bioscience, life sciences capital of the world. We really are. San Francisco, the Mission Bay area, and of course San Diego and La Jolla. And so we have lots of resources. The question is, how do we use those resources? And we do a lot of times use those resources. Sometimes legislation won't seem to reflect the thoughtfulness of all of our expertise, and that's the politics of it. But we do have really good resources, and we do listen to them. And in terms of our water plan, we've spent a lot of time over the last decade and seen that we need to diversify in every part of the state, and that our water plan needs to reflect each geographic area and what's possible to do there. So you have Los Angeles, the basin, San Fernando and San Gabriel looking at groundwater management because that's where they get their water. You see San Diego has pretty much a very diverse portfolio, as I said before. And then you look to the north and they have different. So we are trying to redo our plan in a way that takes into account what we've learned in the last 20 years. So we
Mark
have
Dillon.
It.
Continuing on the environmental theme, the regulatory environment changed last year to allow public utilities to eliminate the tiered rate structure on electricity, which has the effect of increasing the relative burden on smaller low-income users. Eliminating the top tiers eliminates the incentive for large users to cut back and also extends the payback time if you want to install solar. In your spirit of dialogue, is there an advantage to a flat rate that I don't understand?
Well, let me just say I didn't support that piece of legislation because I got information from experts and people about the problems with that approach. So I lost. I didn't vote in the winning side, and the tier structure was put into place. And it is, you know, you will, we are going to see rates increase for any number of reasons. I would say, while I didn't agree, that's what we have before us. And we're going to have more legislation this year that talks about, that may impact our energy rates. One coming out of here locally, Senator Waso, it's 1132, Deanna? 1139. I can't even remember my own bill numbers. 1139, which could impact and raise our rates, but you've got a dialogue going on between labor and creation of jobs and dealing with alternate sources and renewables that our energy companies, the IOUs, have had to fall under in terms of reducing, having more renewables by a certain year and reaching their goals, and this could set them back. So you're right, overlaying some legislation can impact where we are in that. I didn't support that for that very reason. I felt like it was not equitable or justifiable, but, you know, I lost.
Yes, sir.
Jake Edmondson. I wonder if during this drought you're hearing any talk about decommissioning dams through the state. It's a controversial subject, but there are a number of people who think that we should get rid of a number of our reservoirs, and when they're this low, strikes me as logical. Have you heard any talk about that?
Oh, yes. It's certainly part of the larger dialogue that we're having throughout the state, and it's a part of the discussion, and it's why you see the pushback on categories of what we fund and how we fund it. It's why, you know, and you've got legislators, there are 120 of us, 80 assembly members, 40 senators, who come from very different perspectives. And, you know, the environmental community has some heavy concerns about dams and what you do upstream. And so it's part of the discussion, and it tends to lend into the votes that you get to support that level of a category to do that sort of thing. So there's discussion. I don't think it resonates overall, because I think people are so worried right now that if we don't have the increased storage for when we don't have water and rain and snowpack coming down. So it's lost a little of its of the edge on discussion because of the drought, but it is still very much a part of the discussion of people who are very concerned about it and whether it's effective or not.
If I may make a comment, there's a movement, it's not widespread, but the movement, the valley of the Hetch Hetchy Dam, right, where the water supply is for San Francisco. John Muir said of the valley of the Hetch Hetchy that it was more beautiful than the valley of Yosemite.
It is.
And I just know there's that issue. I know there's that movement. It's a little difficult to understand where it's going to go if San Francisco needs its water. But I would like, if I may, with all due respect, make a suggestion. If you go back and look at the Eisenhower years, and we all loved Ike, many people say the greatest single accomplishment was the National Highway Act. And it is quite stunning to me. We've never had a national water plan for America. We have a lot of national plans. We move oil and gas from Texas to Massachusetts and Maine. So what I would like you to consider, dear Madam Speaker, is maybe having a conversation with the governor for the two of you and others to take the lead and suggesting to the president and the people in Washington that maybe it's time for us to have a national water plan. That's just what. Someone here. Yes, I mean Carol.
I have two questions.
Carol.
Your take on the bullet train, or whatever it's called now, and your take on the initiative to divide the state into, what, six parts?
Right. So high-speed rail and the proposal to divide our state into six states. Let me take the easy one first. I'm kidding. Dividing the state. You know, we have a democratic process. We talked about the initiative process that allows us to really have these discussions, and I think it was George Skelton, maybe, might have been George, who said, well, now maybe we better take this dialogue seriously, and so we should have it. I don't agree with it. Number one, Congress has got to support it. Number two, I love saying I'm from California and San Francisco's part of the state, and I love Bakersfield. Long live Buck Owens, or God rest his, yeah. I love Bakersfield, and so I just think it's an interesting discussion, and I wish I had the money the man has who is putting it forward. I'd spend it on some other things that I think are more important. So that's the easy one. But I don't know, if I've offended you and you disagree, I'm sure you'll let me know. I think it's crazy. I'd rather spend our time on other things. High-speed rail, you know, I supported high-speed rail. I think a number of, we obviously did, it passed on the ballot. I think that much like our ballpark, it has many, many lawsuits. When you deal with a project of this size, you're going to have a lot of people with concerns, land use concerns, eminent domain, is it the right route, it's too much money. I think what's really important is that there does need to be a little more accountability, transparency, and explaining the business plan and telling us how it really is going to attract investors. I mean, I've said to the board and the body, tell me who the investors are going to be, because they keep saying they're going to bring investors to the table once the state's commitment is there. That's the business piece of this. The actual development of it, I actually think is a good idea for many reasons. I think we are behind the curve on mass transit and better transit. I wish San Diego weren't at the end of the pipeline on that one, but we do get double tracking out of it. We will get that benefit. I think it will create jobs. I think it ultimately is a better, more sound way, certainly for a state like California. But I do think we have to address people's concerns about how we're paying for it, what it costs. And one thing I did learn, I went to London and I went to Russia to look at their high-speed rail, and they have fabulous systems. But what I did learn is it's expensive. And I think you've got to be honest with citizens and voters that if you want this thing, if you want this product, which, by the way, I noticed in both countries, it did create economic and development opportunities along the route. It absolutely did. I saw housing, I saw businesses. So in that regard, it did what it said it would do, or it can do here, as long as we're paying attention to the business plan. But I do think we have a responsibility and a job to make sure that that voters and citizens have more information. And I will tell you, it's going to cost more, as we already have seen, from the original projections than we thought. It always ends up costing the public domain more than the private, and I think that's the thing we should have been more honest about. And I think there were many of us who believed that it wouldn't. But then if you go to these other places and you start to question them, you realize, the public really paid more of this than the private investors. And I think we got to be honest about that.
Yes. Oh, it's personal. Hey, when did you sneak in?
I am late. I have a random question about the nuclear waste from Fukushima coming our way. Who is monitoring that on behalf of the state of California? And is this sort of taken pretty seriously? And how often do you all get updated on the status of that?
Actually, I don't know all the answers to that question. I do know, of course, I've got Deanna here, and she knows everything. I'm so fortunate. It is something that's being taken seriously. The governor's office has been involved, and I'm not sure what department. Deanna, do you know? I mean, we have not gotten regular updates, but there is work happening, and the governor.
Agency at the state, and there's a whole federal agency that's looking at it, and does regular reports to the Cal EPA.
So it is in process, and it's also for California, Oregon, Washington. There is a coalition of folks from all three states that have been paying attention.
And there are monitors in place all over the western coast that they regularly track.
Thank you. Thanks, Deanna.
Yes, sir, and then Sue Brown, and then Brian.
Two of the biggest financial challenges we face in California, other than the water issue, are public employee pensions and also a tax system that's very pro-cyclical, and where we use income and sales tax to subsidize Prop 13 discount in real estate taxes. Is there any prospect for dealing long-term with both of those issues?
Simple questions. Well, on pensions, you know, I guess I should be thankful that I'm from San Diego and we've had to be on the front end. If you ever want to be on the front end of something, it's not problems like pension reform. But San Diego was kind of on the front end of that. We have actually, in terms of STIRS, you know, we've got PERS and STIRS. And STIRS, we have started, you know, we haven't been in a fiscal position to actually address, because STIRS, the teachers, we have an obligation by statute to be part of the payment plan for that pension system. And so this year we were able to put forward a long-term plan of how we make that system viable over a 30-year period. And we started this year. And of course we're being dinged for not doing enough, but we have a plan and we've started. The teachers are going to be putting in 10%, so their contributions increased. The system, which is the districts, the school districts, and then the state. And the state's putting in 6.3%, I think. So we have a plan on STIRS. PERS, people complain a lot because they feel like we haven't done enough, the governor hasn't done enough on that. But what we started with is what you saw us start with in San Diego. We've gotten rid of airtime and spiking and how you calculate vacation, all those pieces of it. And we still are going to have to figure out probably more things to do. But I think, you know, one of the hugest things is there is an awareness now, and it took us in San Diego realizing the fact that there is no such thing as surplus earnings in a pension system. That money is, there's never surplus. It goes back into the overall system. So things have happened over the last 4 years in both of those systems. And there are critics who will say it's absolutely not enough, but we are having to deal with how to make those systems both solid. And we did tackle STIRS this year, and PERS we tackled in terms of getting rid of the practices that cause us to pay more. That was, what was the second issue? Tax system. Well, we, you know, that's another one of those sacred cows that, number one, elected officials are concerned to try to take on, because there's so many special interest groups and stakeholders that will keep you from passing meaningful legislation. I mean, if you, you know, if you see what how legislation goes through and you have to get the votes, you have to get 41, or in the cases of tax reform, it's usually you have to get 54 votes, you have to get 2/3. So, you know, there hasn't exactly been the political will, and when there is the political will, it gets stifled. We did have one Prop 13 loophole in terms of how property is reassessed so that people can't hide those, you know, hide through how they incorporate that they will be assessed. And I have to tell you, it was one of the most incredible, difficult pieces of legislation to get out of the Assembly. It's in the Senate. We're not sure that it's going to get through the Senate and come back. And it was one small piece of reevaluating Prop 13. So we can talk about political will, but we can talk about reality of people who care about that issue and really politically use their muscle to try to keep the legislature from actually doing anything on that issue.
Susan Braun?
Yes. I'd like to just thank you and comment about education for a moment. The state did put more money into early childhood education. You all did understand the importance of that and did start paying down on Prop 98. Mm-hmm. But we still have a long way to go, and I just wanted to mention we're nowhere near where we were.
1990 levels.
At 1990, right. And
right.
We are still one of the lowest states in the U.S. in terms of funding education, and I would venture to say we probably got the most challenging mix of kids in the state of California, which is more costly. So
we're very diverse, and that diversity has a cost.
I'm just hoping that everybody isn't so thrilled that they've done better this year, and thank God for that, that I don't want to see people sitting back and saying, okay, we don't have to do that anymore.
Sue, we are thrilled that we have finally stopped the cuts. We've stopped the bleeding. And we are thrilled that we have paid back the money that we borrowed from schools. But there is no one that thinks that we're in the best position. We have too many people who actually, you know, education is not my strong suit. I don't come out of education. but I know how important it is to Californians. And secondarily, we have a number of legislators who have real educational background. Thrilled that Dr. Shirley Weber is there, Marty Block, and a ton of others, Susan Bonilla, Buchanan. I mean, there's a lot that have real experience in education, and I'm so glad because they help us understand. But no, we know. We absolutely know.
Byron, Georgia. Thanks again for coming. I have a question that's sort of a parochial interest of mine because I am the chair of an extreme green electric vehicle company, which focuses on working vehicles as opposed to passenger vehicles. And one of the things that I think we haven't done in promoting the utilization of working vehicles is provide any tax incentives of any sort from the state or the federal level. And we're working on it in Washington, and I have the privilege of going on Governor Brown's delegation to Mexico for the next few days. I'm going to be talking to Mary Nichols about it. But the thing I would just impress upon you is this, and I would ask for you to think about whether there's a solution to it. When you take a passenger vehicle that already has a catalytic converter and is relatively clean, you replace it with an all-electric passenger vehicle, you do improve the environment at the margin. But when you attack what we call working vehicles that are in farms, warehouses, police, security, all kinds of actual working vehicles, you with an all-electric vehicle, you're replacing something like a John Deere Gator or a Kawasaki Mule or a Kubota that has no emission control, spews out the most foul of particulates, and with an electric all zero emission vehicle. So we and all of the incentives go to vehicles that can only go on freeways in terms of promoting state purchases of them or promoting tax credits to individuals. And I think that ought to be balanced out, because if you want to address the sources of pollution in the transportation area, they're much greater in the many, and there are many, as many working vehicles in America as there are passenger vehicles.
And I can think of agriculture is an area in which, when they have to meet the requirements of AB 32, it would be, so I think that's the beauty of what we're doing in California, and I think there's room for this, and I think we'll be, I know that we'll be looking at it, and I'm thankful that we have resources and people who are way ahead of us on that, and we're able to take advantage of it and figure out how we're going to incorporate that into what we're doing in California.
Yeah. In light of back to the water issue, in light of the figures that came out on the study on the groundwater last year, is there any possibility of calling moratorium on
fracking? Her question was, given the issue around groundwater management and how dire that is there any discussion about more of a possibility now in a moratorium on fracking moving forward? That's going to be a contentious fight. You've got a legislature that will be incredibly mixed in terms of support for a moratorium. There are a number of people who do support it. We've tried multiple times to have pieces of legislation move forward, multiple members. The governor's approach on this, you know, we did manage to get Senator Pavley's bill last year, which is about transparency and trying to figure out what's going into the chemicals that go into the ground. And I know that we have a report and study coming out by a scientific body that's going to give us more information. By the way, I got beat up on this too, by the way, yeah, the Union Tribune. But, I think we need more information, and we have to keep pushing to get it, because people want to know if they're safe in their communities as it relates to fracking. And the flip side of that, which isn't easy, is this whole coalition of legislators who represent areas in which there are oil refineries. And so it would be a very interesting split vote amongst members of the legislature. And the Republicans would be absolutely opposed to it. And in terms of the Democratic caucus, just to share some politics with you, we have a supermajority in the Democratic legislature in the Assembly. But what that means is we've got an incredibly diverse group of Democrats, a number of them who represent Central Valley and areas with oil refineries, and a larger group of what we would call moderate Democrats who don't support a moratorium. So I don't, if you're asking me honestly what I think versus what I believe in versus what I think will happen, I think it's going to be hard to get a moratorium. But I don't think that means people stop pushing the legislature, because you're a person who has an interest in this. And I think that's part of the process. You know, I got a Coastal Commission bill passed this year to protect access to the coast, so that people who are violating access. Four legislators tried to get this passed for years, and we got it written into the budget this year. And it was something that just said, if you're violating access, you shouldn't be able to do that, and you should be fined. I got that passed. So don't be disheartened. We've got to keep pushing. And the governor doesn't support an end to fracking right now. And his rationale is because we are all still using gasoline in our cars, and we all haven't converted to electric vehicles yet. So this is a dialogue that's going to continue to be very controversial, very heated on both sides. And we are trying to get the scientific information, because we believe we have a responsibility to share that with the public. So don't give up your feelings on this, and don't stop pushing us, because it sometimes takes time.
Last question. Dr. Goldstein, did you have a question? Okay, go ahead. Yeah, last question here.
That's a good point. What she's saying is it takes a heck of a lot of water on fracking, and here we are in a water crisis. Absolutely right. The biggest issues we have to deal with in California are water, energy. So those, I don't disagree with you. I just want you to have the framework for the discussion that we end up having to have all over the place. And
can I just, a quick something occurred to me, because I heard this on NPR, the cloud, you know, you have iPhones and stuff is stored in the cloud, right? Mm-hmm. It's not a cloud. It's this massive building in San Jose that requires every day enough water for a city of 25,000 people. I was just dumbfounded. I had no idea.
Don't give up, though. Let me just...
Last question here.
Related to water. Thank you for continuing to fund the UC Ag Extension. Looking around for ways to save water. You know, in San Diego, we have a lot of avocado growers.
Right.
And they use a lot of water. Well, UC Ag Extension came up with a solution that you can start bragging about if you don't know already. Mm-hmm. They discovered that there's a high-value, high-quality fruit called dragon fruit, and it grows on a cactus. It uses a fraction of the water of avocado. So they're telling the avocado growers, take out some of your avocado plants, put in some dragon fruit. If you haven't had it, you haven't lived. Sorry, George, I didn't bring some.
Thank you.
Just one. Before we properly express our appreciation, let me just say that September 20, which is a Saturday, at First United Methodist Church in Mission Valley, the church plus Temple Emmanuel and the City Club are doing another one of our programs about the drug epidemic in America. And the U.S. attorney, the district attorney, the chief of police, and the sheriff are going to come and give their perspective. I hope you will mark the date. I hope you will come. But if you come, bring somebody young with you. This is so out of control, it's utterly beyond belief. And the national dialogue is not anywhere near what it needs to be. The death of Philip Hoffman, suddenly it put it on the front page. It's now off of the front pages. It needs to be back on the front pages, because the long-term interest of this country is being threatened by the drug epidemic. And now, I think they would like you to have this do or a half.
Wonderful.
Your afternoon soccer, I'm
outing. I love it. Yes, and I am going to run, because I'm very late for afternoon soccer. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your thoughtful question.
Well, I would say two things. How intelligent a speaker, but hey, the audience ain't bad either. Anyway, have a great day.